Yeah, we did have a small dog many years ago. My girlfriend at the time had a small dog. And then, in fact, her mother had another small dog a bit later. And I used to say yip to the dog a lot. The dog used to yip when it wanted to go in or out. And we had another one that used to yip if it wanted to go up or down, you know. It would come up three flights of stairs and it would yip at the top of the stairs because it wanted to get back down again. Mm-hmm. It was called Yipper. That's pretty much what that song came from, was actually small dogs. But it's not about small dogs. It's about actually people consenting to a useless operation designed to prolong someone's life for an extra few weeks while they, in their delirium, imagine this woman, Vera Lynn, who was the force's sweetheart. She was like the Axl Rose of her day, you know. And he's sort of trying to call out to this image in his pain as he's passing away, being destroyed by something. And all these voices are kind of saying, yeah, surgery would be a good idea. Yep, 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 yep. But, you know, originally the song actually was nothing to do with that at all. It was Vera Lynn, Vera Lynn. She played punk rock with her fin. And I imagine Vera Lynn as having this enormous, great black kind of shark's fin on her back that she used it to strum a sort of Les Paul guitar as if she was cleaning her back with a guitar in the bathtub, just stroking this guitar back and forth across her fin, and somehow all these kind of punky chords would be coming out.
This old man, he was flesh. They wheeled him in upon a trolley. Vera Lynn, Vera Lynn. Draw a window on his skin now. Vera Lynn, Vera Lynn. This old man, he was next. Blindfolded to face the folly. Vera Lynn, Vera Lynn. Love will come of all our sins. Painted on my tail of fin now. Vera Lynn, Vera Lynn. This old man persevered. In his mind he lay with Molly. Vera Lynn, with your healing grin, septicemia always wins. Now, Vera Lynn, Vera Lynn. Come a high, come a low. Blood is precious, yes or no. I believe in surgery, and that's a fact. I believe in making it easy. I believe in surgery, but I never act. I believe in making it easy. This old man, he was gone. He was gone and I was sorry. Vera Lynn, Vera Lynn. Down I spiral, down I spin. Forces, sweetheart, I'm your twin now. Vera Lynn,
Arms of Love it was originally called Arms of God. I had it in mind for Roger McGuinn, in fact. REM have done a sort of country version of it, but they've they've changed the chords slightly. And that has wine glasses on it. It has Andy playing wine glasses. We actually had a bunch of wine glasses in the BBC mobile because we recorded it on the BBC mobile, and the BBC came in and put the mics, you know, on the kitchen table like we have here. And Andy just put his moistened finger around the circles of each wine glass top. And that's what that sound is anyway at the beginning. The best thing about it is that as I was writing it, I suddenly realised I didn't have to spend as long getting from one chord to another as I thought. And it would have been a really slow sort of waltz thing. But in fact, I've managed to skip from one chord to another quite fast, so it's quite a concise tune. I mean, I like the tune. And the good thing about it is that it hasn't got very many words, and I keep forgetting them, and I always change them each time I sing it. I changed it from The Arms of God, because that was too much like being, you know, about to be dead. But the idea was that the two people in the song are separated, and soon they will be in the arms of love, but will they be in each other's arms or some other arms, you know? Don't worry, honey. You know, you'll soon be back with me, back with somebody else. What? You don't know. So it could be, you know, it could be the ultimate reassurance, or it could be your worst fears being confirmed. Either way, it'll be quite exciting and probably rather sad. Well, it wouldn't be sad if you got back together again.
Maybe tonight you're aching.
I think it's about the power inside a woman. It's lunar, it's tidal, it's just as the, you know, the menstrual cycle is linked amazingly enough to the passage of the moon, as are, I think, the activities of crabs. And I've never understood why a full moon is powerful, because life on Earth has evolved with the moon. There is now a moon inside of us. You know, if a woman went off to Alpha Centauri or something like that, she would still menstruate in 28-day cycles, at least to begin with. And probably if you took a bunch of crabs and put them on Pluto or something in a huge saltwater tank, they would initially act in sync with the way that the moon affected crabs on Earth. You know, so we've got that lunar element inside of us. And I specifically link it with this particular song is just to do with passion, if you like. The way quite unexpected feelings can come up in people. Just as the sea has all kind of moods. You know, the sea can caress you, the sea can break your neck, the sea can be treacherous, the sea can buoy you up and keep you there, the sea can pull you down and finish you forever. You know, the sea is your mother, the sea is potentially your assassin. Mm-hmm. We supposedly come out of the sea. Maybe if the world ever sort of chokes on its own vomit, the sea will be the last place to be terminally polluted. You know, there must be huge great things down there the size of cathedrals, kind of buried feelings right at the bottom where we can't see. I think this is all just related to the moon inside as sort of, you know, the hidden, the unexplained, the uncontrollable forces of the sea, which again are controlled by the moon.
When the female
Well, railway shoes it's not a term. You know, it's not like we don't say, "Gaw blimey, mate, put your railway shoes on, gov," over back in the old country or anything. It's railway shoes is, I don't know, I was just sitting in the shed in the garden playing the guitar and up came the expression railway shoes. But you know, I like a title. If you've got a title, it's much easier to work from. The Moon Inside, Railway Shoes, they all existed as titles and tunes before they became fleshed into anything definite. I was trying to sound like Richard Butler from The Furs, really. It's meant to sound like Richard Butler trying to be Van Morrison, which is an unholy combination, I think. But my skills as a mimic are obviously waning. No, I was going to ask, you know, we didn't have time to ask people to come and play on the record, but I was thinking of asking Richard to come and sing on the Railway Shoes. I could just hear him on the chorus. Railway Shoes! You know, that kind of thing.
Turning grey. The first time she saw you, she hoped you were gay. It's hard to recover when you're the disease. But I'm ready, I swear it, I'm walking around. Father is right by your side. He's so close to you that he's almost inside. He's guiding your head and he's guiding your limbs. But he isn't you and you know you're not him in your
different versions of When I Was Dead floating around. There's a dub version which has got a lot more space in it. Morris is shaking a bag full of rat's feet. Rat's toenails, I think. And that's what the percussion is. It's all these things going shh. It's not a wide open spaces song. Well, death could equally well be the wide open spaces. I mean, we've made it sound very claustrophobic. You know, when the devil asks him to supper, and then God says he's got all his records, this is obviously happening in a small room, in a cave, by candlelight. The corpse is still in the inner small room, lit by candles. They put some perfume on the corpse to stop it smelling. The mourners are standing around, and they can't communicate with the dead person. The dead person can't communicate with the mourners. All the dead person can see is God and the devil, who've turned up instead. While, you know, Aunt Edith and Cousin Eileen are standing there, weeping piteously by the corpse and strewing the ground with lilies. So again, there's a communication gap between the living and the dead. Given the existence of the universe, all the molecules in it, apart nuclear fission apart and black holes, have been here for billennia or something. They just keep juggling around. So, you know, you've got three of Shakespeare's molecules and you've got two of Himmler's or whatever it is, you know. Part of your fingernail was part of St. Joseph of Arimathea's frontal lobe or something. And, you know, large parts of you were once a daffodil in Nova Scotia or something. And you know, your feet used to be Winston Churchill, whatever it is. You're the same things keep getting recycled. It could be that when we pass away, our psyches dissolve into lots of sort of strips of feeling. All the things that comprise us that were held together by our bodies dissolve, you know, hence I wasn't me to speak of just 1,000 ancient feelings. Feelings that have been around since the beginning of human time.
I was
was listening to a lot of stuff by Love, which was Arthur Lee's group in the 60s when I was in LA making the previous album. I thought, God, yeah, I must try writing more songs where they keep jumping, all these different movements like they used to do in the sort of 60s a lot, sort of having 3-minute songs with, you know, loads of different movements in them. I must write some more jumpy stuff with lots of chords in, like a lot of, you know, Arthur Lee's songs were. And I came back, got drunk. I had jet lag, so I woke up about 3 or 4 hours later with a hangover, and there was nothing to eat in the house, but I was wide awake, and the sun was streaming through the windows, and it was July, and I was suddenly back in England. And I picked up the guitar and made up the wreck of the Arthur Lee, sort of. As you said, it probably doesn't need explaining.
Turn again, never return again. The captain and all his men went up and jumped overboard. Jesus is Lord, they cried.
Driving Aloud is a very impacted song. It's the most like the songs I used to write on the record in terms of being impenetrable or abstruse or something. Not many songs by anyone refer to Harrison Ford. I mean, Harrison is not generally a much sung about person. It was originally called Driving to Portland. I wrote it in the back of the bus. So I was sitting with a cup of tea and the guitar trying to sing in a key that was sort of high enough for me to hear myself over the engine of the bus. And I was playing this riff which I'd made up in the shed the same time I made up Railway Shoes. And I wrote 6 or 7 verses, and I kept verses 1, 2, and 5 or something. And then later, after we'd recorded it, I rushed back and wrote a whole load of extra verses which we had pressed up and then demolished again. So there's a completely different version of the song lying around somewhere with, you know, a load of yet more verses on a completely unrelated topic. But the idea was basically momentum. As if you were talking out the window of a bus, of a slow-moving vehicle to somebody, and somebody asks you a question and you reply, but you're replying not to the person who asked you that question, but to another person who then asks you another question, to which you reply, but that doesn't reach the questioner. It's a series of completely dislocated conversations held together by extreme anxiety, indecision, and a feeling of something ominous about to happen up the road. cope who knows about these things. The serpent is generally a symbol of wisdom as much as a symbol of deceit. The serpent is a symbol of knowledge. I mean, it's the serpent that gives Eve the apple. The idea in my song is that the serpent is guarding wisdom. He's guarding it like a kind of reverse Garden of Eden. But the serpent can't go in, just as I don't know whether the angel that guards the gates of Eden and who drove Adam and Eve from the gates is actually allowed into Eden himself, or itself, because we don't know what sex angels are. Hopefully both. Actually, the idea of a whole load of kind of she-male angels is fantastic, all sort of standing there. But you could imagine Madonna would suddenly burst out of a cardboard box, lured by the presence of such androgyny, which is nothing to do with this song. It's the one on the record I think of as the least kind of Robyn Hitchcocky. I wrote the song almost as a take-off of the band. I imagined Rick Danko doing the lead and the other two coming in. And in the absence of the band, we had to do it ourselves.
Serpent at the gates of wisdom, curling round a tree, with your eyes so dark and empty, looking straight through me. So close to the answer, why don't you go in? Serpent at the gates of wisdom, who did you deceive? She was weak.
I will take control.
I just sang this song, In Your Dust. I was just singing it as I was walking around. Just literally a description of what was happening. You know, it was like a children's picture or something. I mean, that song is totally at face value. It's about one thing and one thing only. And I don't usually write those sort of minor key things. They're a bit dreary, but it just seemed appropriate. And I think we did that around a kitchen table, actually. Morris and I just sat there with acoustics and I sang it live. It's like a lot of simple things. It's great because it's simple. All it is what it appears to be. The nice thing about Wafflehead is that it hasn't got any instruments on it. It's also Captain Beefheart. Beefheart had a song called Hothead, which this is a sort of distant cousin of.
She can burn you up in bed just like she said, because she's a hothead.
And mine is a much more leisurely song. It's been quite a serious record, you know, and I just felt it would be really good to have something that was completely just for the hell of it at the end, you know, that wasn't going to close the whole thing with a sort of, now our hands are folded together in prayer for those we have thought of, you know. Plus, if you just had Then Your Dust, I mean, there's not much else to do. Either it's the heavenly choirs or it's back down to earth, thump, and the wheel of karma starts again. So Wafflehead is just, you know, it's just a love song couched in terms of food, which is something I've been doing for years. I mean, it's like things I've been writing for ages. You know, it's a sort of parody of a Robyn Hitchcock song, really. But it's nice because, I mean, like Morris has a... Morris started mooing. He does the sort of ooms, and then we just sort of made up this cycle of harmonies to go around it. The final mix, it doesn't come out that clearly, but we've got a version of it with a sort of French lead, a mock French lead vocal. You are a wafflehead. The sea of cream is what I beam into her as her eyeballs gleam, kind of like Peter Sellers, Inspector Clouseau. And it's got all the R's that we just evolved this sort of spiral of voices, and we filled up all the, and Andy poured water in stereo between two tracks in a jug. And we went down to the beach to try and sample some squelching noises. I had my gumboots on. And Morris plays a cheese grater, and I got to sing the bass drum part. We didn't even sample it. I just went for 4 minutes. And I take a gulp every 8 bars, you know. So, I mean, we had fun. I'd like to do more things like that.
to step up the stairs, baby.
Love on you, baby. She a waffle.